want to leave one student that we can't provide service to? 2 weeks ago, there were 10 school systems in the state that could not operate because they didn't have enough bus drivers. This is not a city problem. This is not a state problem. This is a country problem. There's a shortage. For every bus driver, it takes 2 to 4 months to train, to put through, to get certified. We are one of the highest paid in our region. It's not the pay. With the federal government providing unemployment at the rate they do, it's sometimes easier to stay home and make more money than go to work every day. And that's a COVID-related problem. Let me just tell you how that's affected us. We have 56 routes. We employ 63 drivers. We put on spares. We put on more than we needed to. Why? In case some of them don't show up. Why are some of them out? At any given time, there's 16 to 20 drivers that we had committed that are out. Long-term, short-term. If I can find that, I can tell you what the breakdown is. So that, you know what, we get facts out. Because it does get tiring to read in the paper and read the criticism of busing when it's not based on any factual data.
So, Shelton, there's among the, I think you said, 10 communities that are facing this problem.
Absolutely not. No, you didn't listen. I said in the last 2 weeks, there are 10 communities in Shelton that had a canceled school because they didn't have enough bus drivers. This is Shelton Student Transportation has never had to cancel school due to a lack of bus drivers. We never canceled school. In March, and I think it's important that you hear this so that you get a budget grasp on this. Am I going too fast for you to type?
No.
Okay. In March, there was 1,270 runs.
You're going too fast for John. Slow down.
In March, there were 1,270 runs. That means from the time a bus leaves and goes on his route, right, that's one run. For the whole month, there were 12,070. The Shelton Student Transportation. And it's too much if we miss one. But the facts are we missed 3 full-time routes. And we missed 3 part-time routes out of 1,270. For the COVID reasons, and we're down so many drivers, that's excellent. Not something we want to live with, and that's why we're doing things to make sure it doesn't happen. And the mayor has been in the front of it. We're up at 5 o'clock in the morning trying to make sure that we have enough drivers or vendors to fill the routes. In April, to date, there were 719. 6 full runs were missed, and 4 runs were out.
What is the
unacceptable.
Difference?
Go ahead.
What's the difference between the missed runs and the when you say a run was out? What is that? What's the
well,
difference?
I said there are 2 types, a full-time run, meaning you missed the morning bringing to school and the afternoon bringing out.
Okay.
The part-time where you just missed one of those, either the morning and the afternoon.
Okay. Thank you.
Mr. Chairman, if you just bear with me, I think it's important to, and I have it here, so I found it.
Absolutely, absolutely. And I couldn't agree with you more. You know, I couldn't agree, you know, any more than you know, more than you have said already. Because it is an important thing. And it's,
drivers out. I'm sorry, Mr. Chairman. 16 to 20 drivers out. What's the summary? 6 were out for specific COVID reasons. We have no control over it. It's all COVID related. They had elderly parents that are 95. They didn't want to take the chance of getting contaminated that time before the vaccine and going home and giving it to their parents. There were some that have young children that didn't want to send them to daycare. There were 4 medical, serious back injury, broken leg, wrist broken. There's a medical standard that we have to uphold that people don't understand. 3 left employment. They left. 1 died unexpectedly on us. And 2 lacked the certification necessary to finish and be a driver. All COVID-related, everything. And now we miss three runs. And what do? We do a lot of things. We start the night before, having staff meetings to see what we need to cover and how we're going to cover that. It goes to 4:45, the manager's in, working on it again. 5:00, we're having a little phone conference to find out where we're standing. And if we can't, we have to notify the school. I want them notified early so the parents have a chance to make their day. And that's what we do every single day.
So budgetary considerations.
Budgetary considerations don't enter into this. And I just want to answer that, Joe, because at the statement, Michelle, that you made, said you had a lot of questions, but you supplied none. You supplied me none.
I actually did ask questions. They're on page 13 of
I couldn't find
the document. It says Shelton Student Transportation Company, Ken Nappy.
Yes. Well, we can go through it. But keep in mind, the only budget item that this board deals with is $3.150 million. And that's not broken down because that's an agreement. We provide the services for $3.15 million. Anything over that, the mayor's agreed to take.
Right. You seem
not to broken down into line items.
You're assuming a lot about what questions I have without actually. Would you like to take a minute to look at the questions?
No,
I'll
go through them one by one, yeah.
Can I ask a question just to go through? So the bus company is $3.1 million. You have that. But are you, as a city bus company, are you using city employees to do the repair of the buses?
They are all city employees that are employed.
Okay.
We have 62 drivers, 20 monitors, and 2 mechanics. I do employ, meaning the city, we do employ outside help if we need some routes covered and people are able to handle. We have one company that's family-owned, that they've been very good. The owner goes out and drives the bus to help us out and cover.
Okay, I understand. So when we're looking at other departments, just so you understand where we're coming from, is we're looking at highways or maintenance and stuff like that, and we're seeing them ask for full-time or part-time employees, but it's some of them are actually working for the bus company. Am I correct?
No, who's that?
I don't know specifically because I don't
know.
Well,
where did you get the information? You must somebody.
But when we're looking at full-time employees and part-time, who are you using to maintain the buses? That's why.
Our own people employed by the city. They're part of the $3.15 million.
So it's difficult to see that in the
budget. Well, that's
the
agreement.
But you should, shouldn't we have a budget line item, John, or something?
All right, Paul, could you?
That was set by the court. That was agreed by the Board of Aldermen. Board of Education, and you have to look at that as a personal service contract. This is the services that we're to provide. This is the amount of money that we provided for.
Okay, and so you...
Let me just say another thing. Go ahead, John.
May I answer my question?
Yes, please.
Do you remember a company by the name of Durham?
Yes.
Do you remember seeing Durham's details?
I'm sure that it had been shared on the bid.
No, you didn't.
Okay, I didn't see it because I wasn't.
You didn't see it because they didn't provide it.
Okay.
This is the same kind of agreement that Board of Ed made with Durham. They made through the courts with us.
Okay.
And we don't have to provide it. We have to just guarantee the service at $3.15 million a year.
Okay.
Not to go over.
Yeah, not to go over. We pick up. City is responsible to pick up any additional cost, and they can't pass it on to the Board of Ed.
Okay.
What we're having difficulty with is that we don't see in the line items in the budget. There are people who are employed. I mean, you just said we have.
But that fluctuates.
We have however many. I think you said 63 drivers and 20 monitors, and so there are concrete expenditures that are being made from the budget, and we don't get budget backup materials that say the way we do with.
I'm not trying to be adversarial.
I think we do, respectfully.
We need to be partners
on this.
What
I'm asking for you to do is to tell us the same breakdown of staff that we get for every other department.
But that's not what it's about in this line. If I can finish. First of all, I'm not being adversarial. This should be a partnership between the administration, the A&T, the Board of Aldermen. That's what we're here for, to see what we can do. And I don't want to get on the political nature, But it's an agreement. It's a contract. It says, I will provide these services. I will paint this room for $150 an hour. You don't say, well, how many painters are you going to stand? What time limit are you going to do? You have something that guides that. And it's the same thing that the court said. We went to it. We negotiated with it. The Board of Education agreed with it. The mediator judge signed off on it.
Right. And this is the last year of the contract, correct?
No, next year.
This upcoming year.
That's correct.
Fiscal
starting,
year 2022 is the
September.
Last year of the
right.
contract. So we are in this position. I couldn't agree with you more. We are trying to be understanding and collaborative in this process of overseeing the finances of the city, which is what we're charged to do.
No, you're not charged to oversee them based on my experience. You're charged to recommend different things. That
and that is correct.
We are charged to recommend.
David Gidwani.
Join the meeting.
But pass a budget, right? And in so doing, we have to understand what the city is spending its money on.
But you have no choice in this case.
I understand that there is an agreement, and I understand that there is a single line item in the budget that says $3.1 million. What I am trying to understand, and I hope that you'll help us to understand, is what are the actual costs that are associated with running the transportation system so that we understand what are the costs of the staffing, what are the costs of the buses, what are the costs of the mechanics?
I don't want to belabor my presentation.
Let me just finish, please.
Sure, go ahead.
Because these are the questions that I asked that unfortunately you haven't gotten a chance to look at yet, and I'd like to give you an opportunity to look at them and to respond to them. There's going to come a time when this city is going to have to decide whether or not to continue with this system, right? We have 1 year remaining on this contract. If we have no understanding of what the actual costs are associated with running this system, we cannot make a decision as to whether or not it should continue. So I don't want there to be this opaqueness to what's happening right now. I want there to be transparency so everybody can understand what the costs are associated with running the system right now.
You want me to answer that?
Yes, please.
We have a contract, an agreement through the court system to provide a level of services at $3.15 million. Whether we have 60 or 65 drivers, it still goes under the $3.15 million. There's a level of services that we're supposed to provide. And I just explained that we've had provided that, except for the COVID that came out unexpectedly. And everybody has to keep that in mind. Again, it's like a personal service contract that you enter into and say, paint this room. You're painting it for $1,500. You don't ask how many painters. You say, what time is it going to be done? What's this? That's part of it. The figures that you have in front of you are figures from 2018. Let me remind you that it's 2021, and the city is giving the Board of Ed the services at the 2018 level. If it were today, it would be. In fact, when they bid it in 2018, it was over $4.3 million. I can't be too specific on that. That's a lot of difference. That's a $1.2, $1.4 million difference. That's the savings. So I guess when it's time to renew, the Board of Education will make their recommendation before it ever comes to the Board of Aldermen.
How can they do that if they don't have the information that I'm asking for right now?
Okay, well, I think at this stage of the game,
satisfied with what their agreement holds for.
So help me understand, when we're looking at the line items in the current budget, where are the drivers? Where is the full?
They're in the $3.15 million. It fluctuates. It fluctuates from 60 drivers, 64. I'm in the process of hiring 8 more. It's still our responsibility to do that at $3.15 million.
So there are, what you're telling us is that there are no, I just want to understand.
Sure.
There are no other line items in the budget that we're looking at right now, the proposed budget, that have anything to do with Shelton school buses or running the school.
Oh, yeah. There's. I'm sure you're familiarized with the budget over 2 years. There's a line item called maintenance. It's $100,000. There's line items that charge for sports activities. That's in the budget. It's both in revenue and expenditures. That's been in there since the beginning, and I'm sure you people are familiarized with that since you work on the budget.
Are there,
there are
there other line items? Are there personnel that are employed by the
budget? No, it's all under the 3.15 million. And we're currently in contract negotiations because it's a union job.
Can you tell us how much has been spent on payroll to date in fiscal year 2021?
Why is that so important?
Okay, I think at this stage of the game, the questions have been asked and they've been answered. And I think we keep belaboring the same point of all the questions that have been answered at this point. So I feel that, you know, unless there's anything further with respect to busing or anything else after that, I think we should just move on. If you have any more questions, I would then suggest that you send them off to him and have it and or the Board of Aldermen and have those questions answered.
In the interest of time, I think this is an important subject that we need to discuss in detail. Each of us has points to make, and I think it ought to be we ought to have the opportunity to make them.
Mr. Chairman, if I could just interject one thing.
Okay, go ahead.
What I move is the microphone.
There are two major costs.
Oh, wait a minute. I think Mr. Angley says one final thing.
If I could just say, when at the end of next year, when the contract is up, the Board of Education is going to go out for bids. They're going to go out and bid the service. And when they get their bids, they're not going to come in with details. Whoever the company started bidding, they're not going to come in with details. Nor are they going to provide the number of drivers, what they're spending it on. They're just going to come in with a number, just like they've done in the past. So I just don't see the importance of belaboring the idea of how much, what is the city doing? The city is fulfilling its contractual agreement that was arrived and agreed on at the court settlement. And we have been flexible in terms of our needs and doing what we have to do to meet that requirement.
Joe Nappick, I think what's being called for here is some delineation and some clarification as per school bus expenses. I think that's what the drive here is. If that could be provided, that would avoid a lot of this A, B, C, D, B squared, whatever you want to call it stuff. Clarification and delineation, if that could be provided, I think this whole bus financial situation would be in a lot better condition.
Mr. Chairman.
Okay, I think at this stage of the game that, you know, we don't need to keep on belaboring the point and continuing to go. We understand what you're trying to say. I think a lot of these questions have been answered. Okay, so I feel that if there's any more questions that you have, sir, you know, to answer with respect to the busing and contracts or anything else, you know, I think we should draw to an end here.
Actually, I have a question. This is Alderman David Gidwani. I would like to know where the excess went when BOE paid for services not rendered.
What excess?
The excess dollars. Where did they go when the buses were not functioning, when kids were at home, learning from home, and not going to school? Where did the money go?
What money?
What do you mean, what money?
Yeah, what money? It's a contract, personal services contract. It says you will provide $3.15 million. Anything over, the city will assume. There are other costs.
Who's talking to me?
There are other costs which you're probably not familiar with, but all of unemployment is spent on this particular item through the city. It's made out of the bus thing.
Right, but the drivers got laid off, right?
Yeah, but we paid them.
Didn't the drivers get laid off?
Yeah, we paid them. We paid the unemployment.
You guys paid the drivers?
We paid the unemployment for the drivers that took unemployment, yes.
And
absolutely.
Is it true or is it not true that about a week ago when Shelton kids had to travel to play games, sports, there were no buses available for them?
That's not true. I don't know where you're getting your information from.
Excuse me?
I don't know where you're getting your information from. We were unable to cover, I think, two games, which were rescheduled. The other games were all covered either by vendors or by us, with someone dropping off a bus company and us picking them up. Part of the problem with the sports activity, which I'm in the process of setting up a meeting with the athletic director, and we talk constantly with other bus companies that have the same type of schedule, is that we can't free up drivers at 1:30 in the afternoon or 2:30 in the afternoon to take the sports trip, because we need to cover with the COVID our school to home. That's our priority.
Well, this bus company that the city has been running is basically been a joke, so.
Well, that's your opinion. I'm sorry.
It's not my opinion. It's opinion about all the taxpayers in Shelton who have kids going to school.
Let's be respectful.
I think we need to just, you know,
cut the
political stuff to an end here, okay?
I get the complaints, and there's not have been a lot of direct complaints to us. I understand you get complaints or some other aldermen or some A&T people, but that's not brought to our attention. I'm in daily contact with the chairman of the Transportation Committee. I'm in daily contact with the Board of Education. We have a process for receiving complaints. So I don't know where the documentation goes. Yes, we missed two or three sports trips. They had to reschedule. But our responsibility is to try to get all of the kids to school and home school. And if you were on when I pointed to the statistics, you will see that we're pretty good in actually providing that service during the COVID. I can't even get to know if we sent bus drivers to get their examinations. I can't get the information who got the shots and who didn't. We're not allowed to get that.
You know what? At the end of the day, taxpayers are going to voice this at the ballots this November, and we will be looking at that.
What does this have to do with the budget?
I came here to try to present the facts that I have, and I think that I've done that. I'm sorry, Mr. Anderson.
And I agree. I think you have done that as well. And unless you have anything further to say, I think that the time has come that we adjourn this meeting.
Well, we still have a number of other questions relating to other departments aside from Mr. Nappy. So,
I'd like to say one thing. You had a comment here about bus safety. All the buses are inspected by the Department of Motor Vehicle. All the buses are certified. We have a system and process and system that there has to be a pre-inspection under law. That's done, and anything that's found is corrected either that day or the next day. But no bus goes out in an unsafe condition, nor one that has not been certified by the Department of Motor Vehicles.
What is the profit that the city is making on the buses that they're, you know, billing the BOE?
The BOE is getting billed $3.15 million under the agreement made with them. I think you're a businessman. I think you realize what a personal service contract is. Again, if you're going to paint this room and say the bids are $1,500, you don't ask how many painters. You
the
say $1,500, yes or no.
This is a city department, and we don't have any other city departments where we don't get to see the line items relating to employees and mechanical failures.
There has been no problems with mechanical failures. I take offense with that also. I just told you.
Well,
all of us, this is certified.
Every vehicle needs to be repaired. That's what I'm referring to.
So, say what?
No matter what automobile or vehicle we're talking about, mechanical failures happen, so we need repairs, right?
And that's under the $3.15 million. And if we go over that...
For every other city department, we have line items that tell us this is what we're spending on full-time.
This is not every city department. This is one that went to court. This was one that was mediated, and this was one that was agreed to by the Board of Education.
The price of the contract was mediated.
The
price of the contract was ordered, but not how we reflect it in our budget. We do not have, and I do not believe that it is best practice from a budgeting standpoint, to have a city department for which we do not have itemized line items for personnel and other budgetary items. And that is what we are asking for. And that's the information that I'm asking you to provide here tonight.
Why do you treat that differently than any other contract?
Because this is a city department
now. This is a contract that was approved. I can't speak to that. This is a contract that was approved. It was approved at $3.15 million.
Is different.
It wasn't approved
from how it is operating. It's operating as a city department. The city asked
under specific conditions of the court.
And we've created a department, and we've created this employment network, and we do not have it reflected in our budget. That is not okay.
I can't speak to why it wasn't done. The court had ruled. The Board of Education agreed to it. It was a one item. And the item was not to exceed.
We didn't even have a line item in the budget until we insisted on it last year.
But the contract and the settlement has
nothing to do with how we reflect it in our budget. That's our responsibility. And our responsibility is to make sure that we're getting what we're paying for. And I don't know how we're supposed to do that when we don't have these items itemized. The other thing I just wanted to say
I think that's different than the Board of Education budget also.
The governor's executive order required that school districts and bus companies enter into negotiations about whether or not contracts were going to be paid. Mm-hmm. I'm not aware that that happened. What I am hearing, and I'd like your comments on this, is that drivers were laid off.
No driver was laid off. The drivers, when we began this process, asked if they can get unemployment compensation. During Christmas breaks, anytime there was no work, they wanted the right to go to unemployment and receive the unemployment benefits.
That's what we upheld.
They all went to unemployment and got total unemployment, which the city paid, number one. Number two, we looked at that, and they made more money going to unemployment than if we had to pay them. So if you want to tell the bus drivers, don't go to unemployment, we'll pay you your salary, which is less than you can collect. I don't believe that's a sound business decision.
So whereas I think this is the concern, and I welcome your response to this, Mr. Nappy, the concern is that because the drivers were unemployed, right? They were collecting unemployment rather than continuing to be paid by the bus company, which was the model that happened for other communities during the COVID pandemic.
Let me finish.
I'm quite familiar with many of those communities, so I will just say that is true. And the reason for that, and the reason for the governor's executive order, was that the drivers were supposed to be available once school was back in session so that they could drive the buses again, rather than being laid off and on unemployment. So there's a concern that because Shelton operated differently and the drivers were collecting unemployment, that they were not then available once school was back in session again. That's the concern.
Right. They were available. However, there were a certain amount of people that decided that they needed to understand COVID, and I explained the reason why the 16 are out. So I don't know what you mean by unavailable. And we got replacements for them.
Some drivers, right, when they're unemployed, would have gone to work for other companies, was the concern. So they were no longer employees of the Shelton Transportation.
Let me tell you, when we took over this, there were six drivers that went with Durham. Let me tell you that those six drivers are back with us.
Okay, so you're saying that was not a problem for Shelton?
No, I'm saying COVID was the problem, not the unemployment, because they got more money being unemployed than they did if we paid them.
Okay, and they were all available.
There was nothing that came in either to the mayor's office, to Mr. Basher or myself, that said, "Where's my money? You know, why aren't we getting paid?" Don't forget, they got 300 twice, plus the other supplements for unemployment. You have to understand how they work. They work by part-time. So they may drive one route, and it lasts for 2.5 hours. And then they may not drive in the afternoon. Then they may drive two in the afternoon, two routes, and none in the morning. So it fluctuates as to how many hours. They don't put in more than 5 hours for the majority of them.
Are you able to tell us whether or not the expenditures associated with the bus company were under $3.15 million, were equal to $3.15 million, or exceeded $3.15 million?
Well, I believe they're going to be under expended of $3.15 million.
You think they're going to be under by the end of this year?
Yep.
Okay. And are you projecting for next year?
No, because the contract is saying $3.15 million.
Right. But remember, part of the agreement was that if it went over, that the city absorbs that cost, right?
That's right.
That cost comes out of this budget somewhere.
If it's over.
Yes. So what I'm asking you
is,
since
we're
now trying to budget, right, and we've had 2 years on this contract that have been partially affected by the pandemic.
1 year, but mainly. The first year wasn't.
For the upcoming year, what information can you tell us that will reassure us as to whether or not we need to budget for additional expenditures in the city budget beyond the $3.15 million?
Based on past experience, we believe that the $3.15 million will be sufficient.
Mr. Chairman, this is Mr. Simonetti. May I speak?
Go ahead, Mr. Simonetti.
Am I out of stance?
Go ahead, Mr. Simonetti. You can speak.
From what I can, what I grasp from what this conversation is, that the city has given a very nice deal to the Board of Education. They're saving about $1 million a year, and they're not being asked to return that to the city unless they don't spend the money that they get in their budget. The city is providing the service that was required by the court agreement. The court agreement did not say they had to divulge what they're spending in any way, shape, or form. The city does agree that if there is more expenses than 3.15, they will not get it from the Board of Education. The money will come from somewhere in the city budget. But from what I can see, the budgeting has been very well done with the cost of the city bus company. And Mr. Nappy and his crew has done an excellent job at running the service with missing very few runs at all. And knowing that when a school changes a schedule because a team can't play or whatever, sometimes the buses wouldn't be available the next time that they wanted them because of the way they're tied up with doing other things. So I think we commend Mr. Nappy and the bus drivers and crews down at the city bus yard, and commend the Department of the Board of Education for having getting a sweet deal. And then with a new negotiating time coming up, we shouldn't be trying to put any numbers anywhere. And that the Board of A&T is going to recommend a budget. They don't set a budget. The Board of Aldermen set the budget.
Respectfully, Mr. Simonetti, I think we should reread the charter because that's not accurate. We did set
a budget. It's exactly accurate.
We set a budget 2 years ago. We set a budget, and it was undone by the Board of Aldermen. That wouldn't have been necessary if it
was. You don't have the right nor the to set a budget. You don't have a right to recommend a budget. Please understand that.
Okay. Well, then we did something that we didn't have the authority to do 2 years ago, and you had to.
You don't have an authority to set a budget, only a recommended budget, and last year you walked out.
That's true, because you weren't allowing us to do this. We had no information, even less information than we have tonight.
Are there any further questions?
Yes, I have a question for. I have a question for Mr. Simonetti.
Comment here. What we need is an account description of the functioning of the contract regarding the city operation of the bus company. Then we will know what's going on and be able to make recommendations as such. There's nothing better than information to make a decision on, and if we could have this information and account description, that would be a help.
Mr. Chairman, all I can say to this is that this is a three-year agreement, so it's not going to be debated whether you pay less or more next year, because it's agreed upon at $3.15 million. That's the only point I'm trying to make with you.
Right, I agree. I agree that that's been said. The point's been taken.
budget for if there's an over expenditure, and we don't know the likelihood of an over expenditure because we don't actually know how much has been spent.
Yes, I said that, that my projections are that there will be under expend. You asked me that question, I answered.
But we don't have anything upon which to base that projection, right? There's no numbers in front of us that show us what the current expenditures are. For every other city department, we have those numbers.
Well, that's an agreed upon.
What was spent in fiscal year 2020? What was spent in fiscal year
2020? That's an agreed upon amount. Again, you're an attorney. You know what contracts are. Somebody gets their contract with your legal firm. They don't say how many paralegals you're going to put on, how many attorneys you're going to set. Just do. No, this is the, this is what it's going to cost you to provide this legal service. And you have to look at it, which I'm sure you're capable of doing the same way. And questions could be asked during a renewal. I don't control that. It goes to the Board of Ed.
I guess we're
going to. It's a part of the Board of Ed's budget.
We're just going to have to.
And keep this in mind, you're arguing about saving $1.2 million.
We don't know whether or not we're saving $1.2 million because we don't know if more than that has been
spent. I just told you last year was the same, and this year there'll be other expenditures, so I don't know what you don't understand.
So maybe Mr. Hiller can provide us with the information that we're looking for from the actual accounts of the city because.
Everything's charged to that one account. Go ahead.
All right, Mr. Hiller, was that you that just said that everything was charged to that same account?
No, that was Mr. Nappy.
That was Mr.
It's charged to that one account. The only two major items that I would point out that are included within the Board of Education budget is the Board of Education pays for the fuel, and they also pay for the cost of the monitors for the buses.
So, Mr. Hiller, do you have the numbers in front of you as to what has been charged against that account for fiscal year 2021?
One other area is sports. It's a special account.
Okay, Mr. Hillard, are you able, you know, would you certainly provide that to her, you know, via email at this point, and or Mr. Nappy, because it seems that you know, we're you know, continuing to belabor, you know, a point instead of moving on.
Mr. Chairman, I just have a comment. It's McPherson. I don't remember in the past this information was requested from Durham or Landmark or whoever else had the contract prior. It just seems that because we're doing it and we're trying to make some kind of a political point here, the judge made it clear, the judge signed off on the agreement, the Board of Ed approved it, and Mr. Nappy stated it repeatedly, that it's 3.15.
Mr. Hill, do you have the figure that I asked for what has been charged against the line item for fiscal year 2021?
To date, and as I indicated earlier, the total budget for the department, which is Department 4200 in the sheets distributed to both the Board of A&T and the Board of Aldermen, has been expended $1,582,000. That does not include any money yet for athletic transportation. That does not include any money for field trips that might have been. As Mr. Nappy indicated, we have been providing transportation. That has not been billed or that has not been served yet.
Great.
But on the part for, there is a line item for bus parts and repair for $100,000, in which $97,556 has been spent. On the daily student transportation, and again, I remind you, as I did earlier, these figures are not up to current.
Right.
$1,484,000 has been spent, primarily be personnel costs. Personnel costs and unemployment costs included.
And is that similar to fiscal year 2020, or do you not have
that
in front of you?
2021. I do not have with me the figures for previous year fiscal 20.
Can you get that for us, please?
I can.
Thank you.
If I may, there's some things that I think we as we progress here, we kind of put in the background and forget about it. And under the old system where we went out to bid, we were paying a vendor a profit in that bid. We were also paying $1 million in that bid per year for the quarters buses. So we took over the school buses, and that cut, you know, cut the cost down a lot on an annual basis. So all this money isn't saved by the city. It's saved for the city, for the taxpayers of the city. You know, it's a question of, unfortunately, having to get to this point, we had to go to court. And this is the agreement to come out of court. We're trying it for 3 years. It was a three-year agreement.
Any surplus, that's a good point. Any surplus that's realized because of savings or efficiency or below cost is money returned to the city. It's not that somebody profits it, like it's a private concern.
We
city
understand.
Money.
We're just trying to figure out where the money is going. And
it's going towards providing that services, like you're telling you.
The point was made earlier that the money was going towards, any savings was going towards education. And I understand that.
I didn't say that. I said the savings from what the contracted rate was to what the mayor decided to charge, which is 18 grades.
I was
that
just
money,
about to say that.
That money.
I understand.
Okay.
That's the savings that you're saying is going towards education.
That's correct.
Within the $3.15 million that's being allocated to the Board of Education and then paid back to the city essentially for transportation services, there may be savings within that that is going to the general fund to pay other expenses. Yes, Mr. Hiller?
That is correct.
Thank you.
I also remind you that the city incurred costs starting in 2013 of purchasing a lease purchase agreement for roughly $5.5 million to purchase the fleet of 60 vehicles. That was paid off in calendar 2018.
May I ask, will we, moving forward with this deal, will we need more buses to be purchased? Will they be bonded? How would this?
I don't have an idea about the fiscal payment of that. The mayor has authorized going out to bid for some smaller vans so that we can utilize a lower level licensee and we don't need a full CDL. We can readily get more drivers that way, and they can do the small pickups. Also, we're looking into smaller vehicles for sports transportation. The reason that Alderman Goodwani is that we missed some of those was not because of a lack of buses, not because of any mechanical failure, not because of any certification, but there's a statewide shortage on bus drivers. And hopefully we're going to be out of that. I mean, I have eight more that are going through the process. So does that eight more mean I go to the board and say I need X number of dollars to improve? Well, absolutely not. Plus, we have summer school.
You know what, Mr. Nappy? There is no other school district in Connecticut that I know of that has a shortage of drivers to drive the kids to a sporting event. So,
well, I disagree with you, but I don't think this is the place to debate.
Okay.
Can I
well, you brought up my name, so I'm defending my name, letting you know that.
I said that I wish Mr. Goodwani was here so that he could hear some of the answers.
Who's that? Mr. Loretti?
It's Mr. Nappy again.
Oh, it's Mr. Nappy again. Okay. Well, as far as I know that there are no other school districts in Connecticut that are having problems transporting the kids to sporting events, and that's where I'm going to rest my case. So All the money that the city of Shelton made last year with not transporting kids, where is the money? Give it back to the Board of Education so they can hire teachers. They could pay the people who need to be at the schools for our children.
David, my job is to try to answer the questions and to answer them honestly, and that's what I'm trying and I'm doing. As far as any surplus, that's not my interest. My interest is to try to get everything and every kid, you missed probably at the beginning, to and from school in a safe manner. And that's what I'm dedicated to do. And I live within the contracts, and I live within that money. And you know me long enough that I tell it like I see it. And that's why I'm appearing here tonight, to try to clarify some of the points. Thank you.
Was the original contract supposed to include field trips and athletic transportation?
No. The original contract was for daily transportation. That's why there's separate numbers for sporting events. So we don't receive any extra money for sporting events.
There's $3.3 million in the budget, including the
Well, you asked me the agreement was $3.15 million.
Right, so that's what we're trying to figure out. So that
yes.
The total amount in the budget right now is $3.3 million. When you add on the additional additional line items that were pointed out by Mr. Hiller, there are some things
right.
that are not included within the contract.
Right, and they're under the purview of the Board of Education. The only monitors we put on are the monitors that the Board of Education says has to go on. So it was not a contractual item because it fluctuated. It fluctuates. Before Mr. Belvin took control, there were 36 monitors. By working with us, we consolidated routes, we consolidated monitors, we consolidated buses, and we were able to bring the number of monitors that the Board of Ed would have to pay for, or the city, from 36 to 20. I think now it's going down to 15. So that was a savings both to the Board of Ed and ultimately to their budget and to the city. Same thing with sports activities. As you know, I mean, it's been in flux whether there's going to be sports activity or not. So if there's not sports activities, the Board of Ed is reaping the benefit of that particular line item. I just want to thank you for coming.
So
again,
question.
It's not an adversarial.
Right.
You know, you're getting the facts as I know, you know, and I hope I've been able to enlighten you on some matters. Thank you.
We had to be here. We thank you for coming. So, but I do have one question. Under that line item 4200, these buses are aging. We didn't use them as much this past year, yet we show budgeting $100,000 to bus parks and repair, but we've used almost $98,000. So when they get back on the road, considering...
Well, they're all back on the road.
Okay. Considering their age... What's it going to be costing the city to keep these buses running and certified?
Well, let me just say that just because the bus doesn't run doesn't mean there's not expenses with that bus. Under state law, it's 3,000 miles or 3 months, regardless if they're used or not, that they have to be brought in, they have to be looked at, they have to be inspected. The brakes and tires are the same thing, yes, if you don't use them. We started rotating buses because we found the previous parties that managed it we're using the same buses for the longest routes. So you get some buses that have 100,000 miles, I'm just giving you a number, and others that have 50. Doesn't make much sense. You need to rotate the buses so that we can get more life out of all the buses. And that's what we've implemented on it. Yes, there's going to have to be purchases of buses. We're debating now what type of buses. Because of the enrollments, could we do with less buses and less routes? We've gone from 60 routes to 54 routes. So those things will be in consideration, but I don't have the authority, nor I do have the ability to recommend where that money comes. All we're doing is putting the specs together, and then I'm sure the mayor will consult with
right.
people in Castor as to what type of bus and which ones need to be replaced.
And what you said here is very important, to know that you implemented the procedure to rotate these buses so they all you know, age out pretty comfortably. So I that's the type of information we're looking to find out. We're not looking to divide what $3,150,000 is going to get us. It's more like what are we looking forward in the new budget that may come up. And we noticed also over these last 2 years with this program that where there's either labor or parts in other departments that have gone higher than what we remember. So we don't know where this money is falling, if it's in truly in the bus, you know, this 14200, or is it also falling in highways and departments, parts? We don't know.
I could tell you that all bus parts, all equipment comes out of this school bus fund and not any other city department.
Okay. And repair.
Our salaries come out of the school bus fund, salaries for the mechanics and everyone else. So it's not that we use a mechanic and charge it to highways and bridges.
Okay, but are there specific mechanics that are working for Highways and Bridges that only work on the buses?
No, there are two mechanics that work specifically for the buses.
And are they listed as full-time or part-time in the highways?
No. There's one, I'm sorry, I take back that, there's one, but his salary is charged to the school rather than to the highway.
Okay. All right, because sometimes we get these, like, well, this is...
Yeah, people tell you things they don't know about.
No, no, it's when we do speak to departments, we find that
sure.
out from the department.
Yeah, there's only one.
So it's one mechanic rather than...
No, you got to listen.
I'm trying.
He said, is there any mechanic that works for Highways and Bridges that works on the bus company? And I said, there's one still listed there, but all of the payment comes out of school funds, school transportation funds. It's not charged, nothing's charged to the highway department.
Okay.
And that was a union matter, by the way.
Ken, are these the same mechanics who were looking at the police cars that are sitting behind the stations right now that are junk?
No. David, I'm glad you brought up that point. Because when the city took over this, this is one thing we tried to do. We hired the same drivers that Durham had. We hired the same management team that Durham had. And we hired the same mechanic that Durham had, although he had left to go full-time with the city. And we recruited him back to stay specifically within the school transportation area there. Also, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you for clarifying
okay.
that, Ken. Thank you.
All right. Very good, Ken. Mr. Nappy there. I appreciate it. Everybody, I appreciate your time tonight and questions. So I think it's time that we say goodnight.
I'm sorry. We still have... lots of other questions that haven't been answered, and I don't see any other department heads here. So what's our plan for that?
The meeting should be continued rather than adjourned. Joe Napik.
There are no other people there to answer the questions that you have.
Well, that's...
And I think at this point, maybe we advance them on to Mr. Hillard.
Ask specifically that the department heads be present to answer the questions.
Okay. Well, they've chosen not to show tonight.
Mayor.
Oh, that's the mayor's fault. They should have shown.
Okay. Well, I think that we'll, I'll ask Mr. Nappy, or as you will, I'll ask Mr. Hillard to reach out to those folks again and see if they want to, appear. If not, nothing more we can do. We can forward those questions off to them and receive them by email.
Mr. Chairman, there's another person here. Do you want to identify yourself?
Tom Harbison, Chairman of Conservation Commission.
Oh. Tom Harbison is here. I had one question for you that you answered by email, and I circulated your answer to the chair. I did indicate to them that there was no requirement for you to attend tonight, but I'm glad to see you.
Very good. Thank you.
Thank you for coming.
Entertaining.
I would like to ask that we, schedule another hearing to speak with the other departments that we have not been able to speak with.
I will ask Mr. Hillard to reach out to them and see what their wishes are at this point.
Their employees, not wishes. The mayor should get his department.
I will ask Mr. Hillard to reach out.
Thank you.
And we'll see what happens after that. Okay.
Well, right now...
I won't hold my breath.
Respectfully, Mr. Chairman, we have a vote scheduled for Thursday evening.
Well, I'll ask Mr. Hillard to, see if he can get that taken care of for us.
I'm not sure what that means.
As I just got through saying, I will ask Mr. Hillard to reach out to those folks, okay, and see if we can't set something up, okay? If not, we can communicate that by email before we end up doing the vote.
One of the issues that your board is facing, and I'd have to check with the city attorney, but the governor's directive as far as the budgetary process, which we adhered to last year, ended the process by 30 days, expired on April 21st. My understanding is, as a result of that, expiration, and it has not been extended by the governor, that we are back to the charter at that point, which requires that the Board of A&T make a recommendation on the budget by April 30th, which is this Friday. The Board of Aldermen, additionally, who didn't pass the budget last year until early June, I'm not certain to the exact date, but I think it was June 5th or 6th, are mandated to pass the budget and adopt a mill rate by May 31st. They have adopted a schedule that they will adopt a their final meeting on the budget and setting of a mill rate will be May 27th. So we do have certain constraints under the charter that we didn't have last year. It was extended by 30 days, and that